Hello, dear church. Good evening once again. And today is 11th of September 2024. I feel blessed and very, very happy to join with you all once again to study the Word of God. Today we have a very interesting story, and the story is from New Testament. We will consider today this incredible story of Dorcas, and we will have some amazing and mind-blowing ending of Dorcas, which will help and know that we pray for one another, we study the Word of God together, we pray for our community center project work. So it's a very, very special time, and I welcome you all for this midweek prayer session on behalf of Hopeside Church family once again. Let's seek the Lord in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for this time, Lord. Please do in. Please help us to contemplate the passages and help us to learn the spiritual walk, dear Father, your desire for our lives. Help us to get closer to you in these last days. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Okay, I invite you to turn your Bible to the Acts, book of Acts chapter 9. And today we are going to read from verse 36 through 43. This is the last story in this chapter, chapter 9. Maybe I will read the verses for you and then we will take point by point from there. Let me read it. I'm in Acts 9, verse 36. There was a woman called Tabitha who lived in Joppa. She was a believer. In the Greek language, her name was Dorcas, which means dear. She was always doing good things to help people. She gave poor people the things that they needed. Dorcas became very ill and then she died. Women washed her body and they put it into a room in upstairs. The believers in Joppa heard that Peter was in nearby town, so they sent two men to go and tell to him, "Please hurry and come to Joppa." Peter then returned to Joppa with the two men. When he arrived at Dorcas' house, some woman took him upstairs. All the widows were there and they were crying. They all stood there near to Peter. They showed him the shirts and the coats that Dorcas had made while she was still with them. Peter sent all these women out of the room. He went down on his knees and he prayed to God. Then he turned his head towards the dead woman and he said, "Tabitha, arise." She opened her eyes. When she saw Peter, she sat up. Peter held her by hand and he helped her to stand up. Then he told the widows and all the believers to come into the room. He showed them that Dorcas was alive again. People everywhere in Joppa heard what had happened. As a result of this, many more people believed in Lord Jesus. Peter stayed in Joppa for many days. He stayed with a man called Simon, who was a tanner. So this is our story today. Now, there is a story of Dorcas. It's a miraculous story. It's a story about a person who was full of good works. This is our title today, Dorcas, full of good works. Dorcas, some new ways to bless others. Now, isn't that really like what a Christian life is all about, wanting to just be good and to bless others? It's not just taking the grace of forgiveness. When you're filled with God's love, it spills out. In life, I try to inculcate this in my kids. With my experience, I have come to a conclusion. Some people who go through life and leave a lake of blessings. They are spilling over in some way that they are contributing, they are producing other kind of people. They are full of vacuum. They are sort of like and taking whatever others produces. Now, everyone has the element of producing and consuming. But the idea is, when our life is over, isn't this earth, would we left more than what we took? And Durga's life is one spilled over in blessings to others. She was a producer. She was a constant giver. She tried to overflow with blessings. She felt a great joy in making other people happy. And it made her so happy. She was always kind and devising new ways to help others, to fulfill their needs and sowing, but still, she always had a thought to remove the pain and the suffering of others. I don't know how she funded herself, whether she was independently wealthy or had some job with a good maybe. Full time, she is plotting and planning the ways that how could she go through her day and be a blessing for others. This was motive. Finally, the Bible testifies about her that she was full of charitable deeds and good works. By the way, if we go to next few verses after Dorcas in Acts chapter 10, it talks about a Gentile. He is not the church member. He is Cornelius. This is a Roman centurion. And he even his good works God and the answer. So God sees and sent an angel to answer him. There are some amazing good people out there. They just love people like Dorcas did and this Cornelius did. God noticed what she did, and the amazing thing about the story that we can read here is this wonderful woman that everybody loves. We are back in Acts 9. She became sick, but that should not be a problem at all because she can always call the church elders to come over, anoint her with. Sometimes we wonder why Christians get sick. That's a completely a different topic, and we will say some of these topics later. Some believe in our churches, we may say like we the idea that the good people won't get sick is not biblical. It's not at all biblical. When we read about Elisha, you know that the great prophet, he did so much of miraculous deeds. He healed so many people. And how does his life end? Bible says he got sickness that eventually took his life. Bible did not say that he died instantly. Here, Dorcas got sick and died. But it was unusual because it was a premature death. She was young. And some young people get sick and die also nowadays. Some bad things happen even to some very good people in this world. But it does not mean it's the will of God. Sometimes it is meant for the glory of God. Here I don't want which I was making that she is full of good works. If we look in Titus chapter 2 verse 11, how does God identify his people? Here in this chapter, like verses 11 through 14, it says they are zealous, they are enthusiastic, they are passionate about good works, they are full of good deeds, they are doing charitable things. When Jesus said the parable about Good Samaritan, it is very interesting that when beaten, in fact, half murdered, sick, helpless, but when two church leaders came by, the Levite and a priest, they did nothing. They just looked. And then finally a foreigner, a Samaritan comes by, he not only give him a immediate, at least he could have left him there, but he stays with him in the hotel and takes care of him. He nurtures more money to the innkeeper to see his full recovery. He takes a complete full responsibility for his healing and well-being. He is not even a member of church. And in that story, Jesus tells us who is the neighbor for him who fell among the thieves. Who was the Lord really thrilled with? Who had the real care and the concern of his fellow men, right? God is especially pleased to know that we love our fellow men. May the Holy Spirit to us in our capacity to help them. And let us ask God, how can I be a blessing for others? A lot of times it's not just words. A lot of time it's our attitude, being kind and being cheerful, being positive. We can find opportunities around us all the times to do those things. In Hebrews 13:20, it says we are still talking about the zealous of good works. Now, God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of sheep, through the blood of everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will. Christians ought to do good works. We are supposed to be transformed in the image of Christ, imitating what he did. And what did Jesus do? He went about doing good, right? Bible says it. In he and oppressed by the devil. Even good people suffer and struggle. These trials in this world are very, very real. When we read about Job, we can see that his family wiped out. So many bad things can happen to a good people too. And died. Sometimes we ask lots of questions and ask why. But the good news is every man that loves the Lord and loves the fellow man has nothing to do with the fear of death because they get resurrected. Maybe in this life like Dorcas or definitely in the next life. We don't need to worry at all. Man, in fact, I feel so sorry for Dorcas because they did not brought her back for Dorcas, but for them. The church needed her service. She was so valuable. And it says she cared about to make sure that the people were clothed. She got sick and died, and the Bible says they washed her body. Dr. Luke recorded this. And it's very sure that she died. Her body is blue and cold. She was not at all in coma. For sure, they all knew that body was dead. They had prepared her for burial. There is no breath in her. They wrapped up her, ready for burial. But then they sent somebody to fetch Peter. They didn't expect him to come and to do her funeral service. Definitely not. Because they told, come quickly, do not delay. Why did they send Peter for Peter? I think they were all hoping for her resurrection. In the Bible, Jesus tells his apostles to raise the dead. We can read this in Matthew 10, verses 6 through 8. If you read, like it says, God is giving the commandment to them, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely give. So this is the commandment of Jesus. So Peter raised the dead, Paul raised the dead, but God expects us to continue going and raising the dead. It pours out in the last days, we might see some of the same or in the early church leaders who are doing that. We will realize up until this time, no apostles has raised somebody. Dorcas was the first person messengers to Peter and asked him to come quickly without any delay. Peter comes here and he is a real servant of the church. He comes and he wept with them. When today. So now they all understood the state of death very clearly. They knew that she was dead for sure. But the other thing I found, which was that industry. She seemed to be really, really busy with sewing mission back then. It reminded me of some Bible verses here. Like Job 31, 19. Job is saying here, he was always cared for those who are in cold. That is what a Christian religion is. James 12:127 talks about the basic Christianity here. It is the bottom line of James, and he says, pure religion and undefiled before God the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, to keep himself unspotted from the world, which means ministering to them, live a holy life, care for those who are unfortunate from the government or the church. But it is because it is in your heart. Sometimes we want to do things only when we get the orders. Now, in Proverbs 31, it talks about the ideal Christian woman. She is the type of God's church. That woman, God's bride, who was always keep the people warm and in light. This is the kind of influence the church needs to have in the society. Here in our story, all the widows came and showed their clothes because warm from cold. Clothing in the Bible not only represent the covering of your back, like keep you from physical nakedness, but it also represents covering with the righteousness of Christ. She was constantly busy with her work to provide a covering for them. For those who are uncovered, helping them to provide warmth. Isn't that the part of Christian church? To help people to have the robe of righteousness that Jesus provides and to cover their nakedness and their sin. Coming back to our story, here Peter knelt down and prayed. Now, it is not necessary always for us to kneel and pray. But it is appropriate to come in the presence of the Holy God in special occasion to show our reverence if we are able to. If we are not able to, we have some knee problem, we can understand that. But if you're getting ready to ask for resurrection, it's better for us to kneel because it does not happen very often. Resurrection prayers are pretty big prayers. Maybe this is in the story is in the Bible, just not to tell us about the power of the Lord to raise from the dead. Maybe one of the reasons this story is in the Bible is to encourage us to live those kind of lives. I have attended few funerals and I've heard wonderful stories which moved my heart to know how one life affected so many people's life in a very, very positive way. Here in Durga's life, everybody said that we cannot afford to lose her. She is such a wonderful blessing. She is the light, moral it for everyone in the town, and they prayed that she should come back. And that great influence for good, that person is full of good works, came back through prayer. There was a resurrection of good works in that church. Maybe we all need to be praying for that in our churches today, for God to work out a miracle and bring new life in our churches today, resurrecting a spirit that's just wanting to do good for everyone around them. I think God is so pleased with Durkas, even though she could have come back while Jesus returns, but still, If the church needs her, God is willing to resurrect her again. What this incident would have done for the testimony of gospel, if we were living in Joppa, just imagine we heard this news of Dorcas, that they were a very sincere Christian who was full of good works, and she died and let her come back to her life through the prayers of church members and apostles. Will that not tempt us to be a Christian? That's a great life insurance, right? God notices the things like that. And this testimony went far and wide, and all because the goodness of like the theology, the truth will set us free. But the people are a lot more interested in hearing in what we believe in theology after they see that we love. So I would like to challenge myself and you that let us all make this way lives for good. I want people to say the good things if let us have our lives of protection and good, influence for good, not just the life to consume and take. This is what the real Christianity is all about. Let us use the gifts that God has given us to help others. Let us stay faithful in doing good for others. Let us build relationships that will have everlasting impact on others. Let us make service and ministry to others as important. Be a witness to others. Dorcas, who had shown many people God's love, but her death and return to life pointed even more directly to God. There was certainly a great rejoicing that when she was restored, as well as celebrating God's wonderful work, we have a chance to lead others to know God better through how we go through each day, especially the difficult ones. Carpe love in our community. Let us be alert for practical needs that we can help meet. Let us be aware of prayer needs and faithfully lift them up. Let us be ready to share our personal testimony. God has always lifted women to bring positive change in their surroundings, in her life. She is still a wonderful example of what it means to submit our talents to the Lord and to leave the legacy behind. And God will always multiply the blessings that come from our selfless giving. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, let us stand firm. Let nothing move us. Always let us give fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that our labor in the Lord is not in vain, according to 1 Corinthians 15:58. So let us all take courage and let us be a great blessing for others in and around us. May the Lord bless you all with this message. Let us seal this decision with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this gospel message. We pray to revive our hearts, to pour out your spirit of goodness, that we may be great blessed. Let us be this path in our churches. By seeing our lives and associating with us, let the people taste the goodness of the Lord. Please bless us to bless others and provide for us to provide for others. Give us compassionate and empathizing heart towards those who are less fortunate than us. We pray that you will help our church to be like Dorcas, full of good works, full of charitable deeds. Lord, make us your servants and fill us with your Holy Spirit. Lead us towards the path of resurrection. Lord, we specially pray for each and every family of the Hopeside Church. Continue to be with them, dear Father. Bless them abundantly. and fulfill all their needs, dear Father. We know there are so much people in our church, families in our church who are jobless, financially broken. Please open a way for them, dear Father, and help them to come out of their difficult situations and trials. Bless our children and youth. Help them to take all their decisions in their lives to please you according to your will. Protect us and our youths and our children from any harm and danger or any spiritual attacks, dear Father. We especially pray for the sick people. Please bless them and help them to be recovered speedily. We also pray for the community center project work, dear Father. Bless that the project would have enough resources to accomplish the work to be done, and let it serve the purpose of serving community. And in Jesus' precious name we ask, amen and amen. That was wonderful studying the Word of God with you all once again. I'm so blessed. Hope to meet you all next week. So have a very blessed week ahead. God bless you all.